Cape Elizabeth Planning Board for Tuesday, September the 16th, 1997. The first order of business is the minutes of the previous meeting of July the 15th, 1997. We did not meet in August because there was no business in August. Do I have any corrections or additions to the minutes of the July meeting?
No.
I'd just like to point out a typo.
Mm-hmm.
Page 3, second line from the bottom.
Mm-hmm. Public.
Public.
Oh. No F.
Thank you. You didn't know that so many reasons.
Thank you. I guess you read it.
Any other corrections or additions to the minutes? If not, do I have a motion?
So moved.
That they are approved as amended by the one typo. All in favor? Raise your right hand. Unanimous. All right. I'd like to note for the record correspondence that we've received since the last meeting. A letter from Mr. and Mrs. Murray regarding the Rancourt daycare application. A letter from John Upton regarding the Beacon Lane public access waiver. Another letter from John Upton regarding the Beacon Lane public access waiver. A letter from Michael McGovern regarding the Beacon Lane public access waiver. A letter from the town attorney regarding the MC Associates appeal. A letter from the town attorney regarding the MC Associates variance request. A letter from Owen McCullough regarding the Hinkle property. A letter from Seth Sprague regarding the Sprague master plan. A letter from Michael Healy regarding the Sprague master plan. And then in our packets, the zoning news for July of 97, Planning Commissioner's Journal for the summer of 97, APA training sessions memoranda, and a memorandum from the Public Works Director regarding the Highlands. Also on the podium this evening, not distributed in our packets, is a letter to the town planner from John and Mary Ingalls regarding the Rancourt daycare proposal, a letter from Ruth Brennan regarding the same application, and a letter from Evans Huber at Kassler and Feuer in Boston regarding the Sprague Corporation. The first item on our agenda this evening is something that is scheduled right now for the consent agenda, and that is the Highland Subdivision cul-de-sac plantings. Peter Kennedy is requesting amendments to the previously approved Highland subdivision to add two planted cul-de-sac islands at the end of Heritage Court and Cove View Roads under Section 16-2-5, amendment to a previously approved subdivision. Maureen, do you want to be heard on this one? Excuse me? Oh, absolutely, yes. Thank you.
Madam Chair,
Mr. Parkhurst?
I recused myself of the last discussion on the subdivision, so I'll do the same.
I remember that you did, Mr. Emery, so thank you. That still leaves a critical mass. So we are dealing with this, or at least it's right now on the consent agenda. Do I need to be heard? Do I need to hear you further on that, Mark?
No.
Okay. Would you like to tell us what this is about?
Certainly. Mr. Kennedy is proposing to create two cul-de-sac islands in the middle of two previously approved cul-de-sacs. And in the islands, he would plant Rosa rugosa and bayberry bushes. The Public Works Director has seen this plan, and his request is that the bark mulch that is proposed for the edge around these bushes actually be loamed and seeded because he feels it's easier for him to maintain and it'll have a better appearance over time. In terms of how the board wants to handle this, I have proposed it as a consent agenda item. If the board considers this to be a change to a public right-of-way, then you probably want to pull it off the consent agenda, put it on the regular agenda where you can have Mr. Kennedy make a presentation, you can discuss it, you can decide whether or not to hold a public hearing, and then you can vote on whether or not to table it or to approve it, or to deny it, or to postpone it at some future date. If everyone is comfortable that this is such a minor change that it can be placed on the consent agenda, then all you need to do is make a motion to approve the consent agenda, and what I've drafted incorporates the request by the Public Works Director. Are there any questions?
Was the, in the original subdivision plan, were the islands in the cul-de-sac?
No, that right now the cul-de-sac is a big round pavement area. and everyone seems to feel that this will aesthetically make a much better appearance.
So it was open?
Pardon me?
The cul-de-sac was...
Open and paved.
Open, completely open.
Completely open and paved. It's been designed so that it's still not going to be blocking emergency access. It's just a planted island in the center of what otherwise would be a big, round, paved central area.
And the reason for this is what?
Aesthetics.
And the 30 feet indicated on the drawing is around the entire cul-de-sac?
The 30 feet...
I'm looking at...
top drawing.
Well, it's the only drawing I have. It's attached to the Kennedy.
Right, and the diagram at the top is actually a reproduction of a spec that appears in our subdivision plan, in our subdivision ordinance. Mr. Kennedy is representing that he's designing the cul-de-sac exactly to replicate what is already a spec in our subdivision ordinance.
Do you have any background on why this came up?
I believe Mr. Kennedy just felt that a wide paved area without some kind of planting to relieve it was aesthetically not very pleasing.
But this is a cul-de-sac at the end of a street.
That's right.
And originally approved that way by the planning board at the time it was approved.
Absolutely.
Which was when?
The original approval was in 1991.
Thank you.
Any further questions, Mr. Asley? Okay.
No, Mr. Chair, I just wanted some...
Fair enough. I think that's, you know, you certainly, since you weren't on the board at the time that the approval was granted, entitled to have the background information. Seems to me the first item of business is to determine whether this is appropriately on the consent agenda as opposed to the full agenda. Do I have any comments from the board members on that? Mr. Wilcox.
Madam Chair, I believe that it is appropriate for this to be on the consent agenda.
I agree.
Mr. Cotter, I think I agree as well. This seems to be well within the purview of what we anticipated when we set up the mechanism for the consent agenda. So I am certainly comfortable with the reference to the town planner to make decisions of this sort, and have no difficulty with what you've suggested. I guess my only question is, has Mr. Kennedy been consulted with respect to the Public Works Director's suggestion, and is he in accordance with it?
I forwarded the memo to the Public Works, from the Public Works Director to Mr. Kennedy. I haven't heard back whether you're okay with that or not.
Yes, I can confirm the dimension of the grass.
Any area you'd be putting bark mulch, instead you'd be loaming and seeding. So whatever dimension you originally proposed for bark mulch would now be loamed and seeded.
We're going to put bark mulch around the planting.
Mr. Kennedy, if we're going to have discussion, it would be handy if you would come to the podium, if you don't mind, and identify yourself, please.
My name is Peter Kennedy. I'm the developer of the Highlands. We were going to put bark mulch around the plantings, and I understand Bob Malley would like to see grass around the perimeter of the cul-de-sac. So I'd be happy to coordinate with Bob to see how far deep he wants the grass to go in next to the plantings, because he will be maintaining the grass.
Right.
And he may well propose some bark right around the plantings themselves, but fine, I'm sure you can coordinate with Bob on that, so. Okay, then all in favor of putting this on the consent agenda and disposing of it that way, please raise your right hand. It's unanimous among the four of us. And I think that's the disposition then. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
The next order of business is the Woodland South site plan, a request by Richard Davis for site plan review of a new business office for the Woodland South Apartments, to to be located adjacent to the parking lot of Woodland South, located at the corner of Woodland Road and Mitchell Road, be considered under Section 19-9-4, Site Plan Completeness. Mr. Davis.
Just have a moment to put...
Sure, by all means.
Yes, good evening. My name is Arlen Davis. I'm the manager of the Woodland South Apartment Complex at Woodland and Mitchell Roads, and I'm here this evening with a request to construct a new building to be used as a rental office for the apartment complex. The building would be located adjacent to our existing main parking lot and next to an existing utility building that we currently have on the site. The building itself would be a one-story wood structure. It would have cedar shakes and asphalt shingles. It would be very similar to the features on the other buildings at the complex. It would have a small planting strip along the front with the same type of plantings that are in front of our other buildings there. A small asphalt ramp leading to the building, and it would have a residential character to it that I'd like to try to keep the same as the rest of the existing buildings there, and hopefully have a project that somewhat disappears after it's built into the complex and becomes an attractive use for the property. The utilities for the building would be completely serviced from the existing infrastructure.
Excuse me, Mr. Davis, I think we're getting some interference from the back, and somebody's... Ron, would you also make sure that they know we're here so that we'll be not interrupted again? Okay, fair enough. I just wanted to make sure we were taken care of. Thank you. Appreciate it.
Yeah, there was one group that left earlier, and I think that was it.
Well, let the record show that the parking lot is quite full tonight, and I don't think it's because everybody's here before the planning board, so the building is in full use tonight.
Probably not.
Excuse the interruption.
Certainly. The utilities, as I was saying, would be entirely confined to within the perimeter of the property. I've had several of the engineers from the different utilities on the site and gone over all of my expectations for the project with them, and I haven't met any resistance in that regard as far as power and telephone and so forth from within one of our existing buildings on the site. And the parking and trash removal and so forth that would be associated with other projects, we plan on using the existing parking lot we're using now. There's not going to be any increase in traffic that isn't already there at the existing rental office. And we currently use, a solid waste dumpster on the site. And we have a pole lighting for the area. So I'm not really planning any lighting for the building as well, other than the small carriage lantern on the front of the building. There won't be any signs, with the exception of possibly a small brass sign on the door itself, maybe a 3x8 or something like that. We've tried to show it on the building plan itself. But I think that the sketch is very representative of exactly my intentions for the project. And I guess I'd defer to you for questions.
Fair enough. Thank you. Our first order of business is determine the completeness of the application, and perhaps the planner would run us down the checklist quickly and see what we're asking for in the way of waivers and what the record looks like.
I just would like to point out to the planning board, this is the first time you've done site plan review under the new site plan regulations and the new zoning ordinance. So some of the checklists have been slightly revised, and the standards are going to look a little different as well. But if you could flip to the page that's titled Site Plan Review Submission Checklist, which I believe is the fourth page in on the memo, this is a summary of all the items that are required under the new ordinance. And under number 7, building setback, sideline, and rear yard distance, the applicant had asked for a waiver providing that information. Under number 10, parking, loading, and unloading area locations, again, the applicant has asked for a waiver of that. They're not proposing to change any of the parking amounts. They don't believe that the proposed use will generate any more parking demand than is currently needed. And under 12A, location of design of existing and proposed stormwater systems, the applicant has requested a waiver of that information. However, I've indicated it is at least partially complete because they have submitted some information. They've had an engineer go out and look at the site and make determination that this impact will be very small and is too small to calculate using standard stormwater calculation methods. Finally, under number 16, technical and financial capability, the applicant has asked for a waiver of submitting that information. Any questions?
Any questions from the board on any of the waiver items or any of the other items? Mr. Wilcox.
The only question that I had was with regard to sewage disposal. Is this part of an existing development, or will this require some type of a connection permit from the town for that?
The applicant is proposing to connect to the sewer, and because it's in the sewer service area, I'm not sure whether he would, I would assume he's going to need some kind of permit, although you may be connecting to an existing sewer pipe on the site, and maybe private, but in either case, it's in the sewer service area, so he's entitled to a sewer permit.
Okay, thank you.
Mr. Davis, the only question I had involved the first item on the checklist, which was the evidence of right title and interest. I note on the application that the applicant is Richard A. Davis and Willard N.V. Trust. Is that a Netherlands Antilles Trust?
Excuse me, I'm sorry, I didn't catch
that. I was just wondering who the actual record owner of the property was.
Those are the record owners.
And Richard A. Davis is your somebody, your father?
He's my father, yes.
Okay. And the Willard N.V. Trust, is that a Netherlands Antilles Trust, or do you know anything about it?
That is a trust of another family.
I'm sorry?
That's a trust of another family that's a co-owner in the property.
Okay. I don't have any more questions on the completeness part of things. If there are no other comments from the board, I think we should... do I hear a motion that the application is to be deemed complete?
So moved.
Second?
Second.
All in favor, raise your right hand. Unanimous? Okay. Then, beginning the substantive discussion of the application, anybody have any questions or comments on the substance? Mr. Aslino?
Sir, what will this building be used for? I know it says it's an office, but it's 900 square feet approximately. What are you going to do in there?
It's going to take the place of the current rental office that we have on the property.
Which is located where now?
In one of the apartment buildings itself. We currently use one of the units.
One of the apartment units?
Yes.
So this is rental, administrative office, that sort of thing?
That's correct.
And there would be, how many people in there during the normal business hours? I don't mean people coming to rent, I mean employees of the company.
Right. I expect probably only two.
That was my only question.
Mm-hmm. Any other questions? Okay. We have the choice to, let me ask the town planner, since this application was filed, I take it there have been the regular notices mailed out to abutters and whatnot. Has there been any interest shown in this application by any citizenry of Cape Elizabeth?
No. No. I can tell you that I had a conversation with the Conservation Commission chair this afternoon. The board had asked some questions about wetlands immediately south of the existing parking lot.
That was at the workshop.
That's right.
The application made.
And he went out there this afternoon and explained to me that what he found was a strip of area that was probably about a quarter acre immediately south of the parking lot, that because it's a quarter acre at best would be an RP2 wetland. He also located another wetland further south of much larger size, probably an RP1. But again, it looks like it's separated from the development site by a ridge of land, and it appears to be 250 feet away. So it doesn't appear to be within a buffer area of this particular project. That's the only comment I've heard.
And the issues that were raised at the workshop, that really was the issue of usage and the issue of the wetlands were really the two things that we pressed the applicant on, as I recall.
I think that there was also a question about topography, elevations, and drainage.
That's correct. That's right. Okay. I suppose before we take a vote, we ought to think about, is there any desirability in having a public hearing? Are we interested in a site walk? If so, we ought to schedule it. If not, we ought to proceed to discuss this application further. Anybody have any comments? Mr. Emery?
There's nothing on the face of this application that seems terribly onerous. I guess the people who are most seriously affected are the people who reside in the adjacent buildings. Therefore, I don't see that there's any terrible public need for either a site walk or a public hearing. And I assume that the occupants of the buildings were notified or have reviewed the plan?
No, I haven't briefed any
renters
of...
Renters aren't noticed in Cape Elizabeth?
The residents.
Oh, the property owners.
Property owners, okay. There's not much they could do about it anyway. So I don't see any need. My only comment is that there's a ramp here and it's labeled on the elevations, a handicap ramp, just to be sure that it's of adequate width. It doesn't appear to be in the building elevation, but there needs to be room on one side of the door so that a wheelchair can move to the side and pull the door open or push the door in, whatever the case is. That's a, you know, fine detail. It should be picked up in the building permit application.
Do you understand what he's saying, Mr. Davis?
Yes, I do.
Good catch, Tom. Any other comments?
I'm prepared to make a motion if it's appropriate.
I think it is.
We already found it complete.
Why don't we do this in the regular way? I think we have, but why don't we do it in the nice way that Maureen has laid out?
Well, I blanked out there for a minute. Motion for completeness. Be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of Richard A. Davis for site plan review to construct a management office for the Woodlands South Apartments located at the corner of Mitchell and Woodlands Road be deemed complete.
Is there a second?
Second.
All in favor of the motion? There we go. It's official.
Motion for approval. Findings of facts. Richard A. Davis is proposing to construct a management office for the Woodlands South Apartments located at the corner of Mitchell and Woodlands Road, which requires site plan review under Section 19-9-2. The applicant substantially complies with the site plan standards, Section 19-9-5. Therefore, be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of Richard A. Davis for site plan review to construct a management office for the Woodlands South Apartments located at the corner of Mitchell and Woodlands Road be granted with the following condition. One, that the use of the building be limited to management of the Woodland South Apartments.
Second.
Any discussion of the motion? Mr. Azulino?
I don't know who to pose this to, you, Madam Chair, or the planner. But you did comment, Maureen, this is the first approval under the new standards. I have a question, and maybe nobody else, maybe it doesn't matter, but I'll throw it out. Is the condition that the use of the building be limited to management of the Woodland South Apartments clear enough in everybody's mind?
What's your question about?
My question is, what does that mean? What does that, does that need to be further defined?
If you were to further define it, how would you do so?
That's also a good question. It seems to me to be very broad, and maybe it's fine. And if it doesn't bother anybody else, I suppose it really doesn't bother me. But we're approving a building to be used exclusively to manage the Woodland South Apartments. Management is a very broad term. I think we all view that as an administrative office. Perhaps we should say a rental office, perhaps we should. I don't want to make it unduly restrictive, but it's the first, this is the first one, and it concerns me a little bit that it's pretty general, but Maureen, I'll defer to your judgment in that regard. Is that, if it doesn't bother anybody else, I'm not going to let it bother me.
I believe when we talked with the applicant before, he said he was going to be managing some other property from this office as well. Didn't you indicate that there was another piece of property someplace else that you'd be managing from this office?
No, I'm not going to manage any other property from this office.
Sorry.
That was a piece of property I had personally that I mentioned, but no commercial activity for management.
I guess the point I was trying to make here, I mean, if you're going to be managing this property and a personal property, it doesn't, wouldn't bother me under any circumstances.
Okay, well, let me propose a clarification.
Mr. Azulino.
I would propose that we change the only condition as follows, that the use of the building be limited to the administrative functions associated with the management of the Woodland South Apartments.
Is there a second to that? Actually, would you accept that as an amendment to your
motion? I think the point that's being made here is that Mr. Davis becomes the next Donald Trump, that we wouldn't expect to find 7 cars or 12 cars lined up in the parking lot waiting to rent spaces in East Holden and South Brewer and Bangor. And
yes, that's the point.
I'd be glad to come back and get an expansion of the building.
Well, at least you know you're supposed to come back to the planning board. That's a good sign, Mr. Davis.
To answer this gentleman's question here, I don't anticipate doing anything more than what I've been doing for years in the office that I occupy now. I don't anticipate any particular change. I am down 2 employees presently, but I don't anticipate any change.
Does the wording restrict you in any way? The amendment to the wording, do you feel that restricts you in any way?
I really don't feel it makes a lot of difference, because that's my function when I'm there on that property.
All right, thank you.
For Woodland South, yes.
Certainly acceptable to me.
Fair enough. I take it it's acceptable to Mr. Parkhurst as the seconder. Any further discussion of the motion? Okay, you have the motion before you with the condition stated that the use of the building be limited to the administrative functions relating to the management of the Woodland South Apartments. All in favor of the motion, raise your right hand. It is unanimous. Okay. Thank you very much, and best wishes with the project.
Thank you.
Okay. Give you a minute to get your items down. The next order of business, and I will say that it's a pleasure to run ahead of schedule rather than behind schedule, is the Rancourt Daycare Facility site plan. This is a request by Dana Rancourt and Lisa Manini for site plan review to operate a daycare facility at 111 Scott Dyer Road, considered under section 19-9-4, site plan complete. This is the second site plan review under the new ordinance. Ms. Manini or Mr. Rancourt, if you want to identify yourselves, tell us what the application's all about.
My name is Lisa Manini. It's my fiance, Dana Rancourt, and we live at 111 Scott Dyer Road. We are applying to the Planning Board to operate a home daycare facility for seven or more children under the age of 16 in our home at 111 Scott Dyer Road. Specifically, we will target school-age children whose parents want to encourage and foster multiple opportunities for their child to interact with the residents of the Viking Nursing Facility directly across the street. In changing times and family structures which distance grandparents from grandchildren, we hope to provide more opportunities for intergenerational sharing. In addition to the shared holiday programming, cross-generation visits, and an adopt-a-grandparent program, these school-aged children will be provided with equipment for planned group and individual activities, which will reflect the social, emotional, physical, and cognitive needs of this age group. The program shall allow time for individual self-directed enrichment activities when appropriate. A certified and knowledgeable child developmental specialist will be retained to assist in developing a varied and exciting enrichment program for the children, geared to their individual needs and skills. Opportunities to learn lifelong craft skills, interaction with their peers, and exposure to the world of computers will be available at our center. Center's hours will be from 7 a.m. to 7 p.m. Monday through Friday. As the operator, I am currently enrolled in a child development class at SMTC. I'm from a large family with 14 nieces and nephews and come with a lifelong love for being around children. We have been before the zoning board, which gave us approval for a conditional use permit. We're here tonight to present our proposed site improvements for your review and approval. Our parking and traffic patterns in and out of the driveway has been revised. The circular drive and the widening of the driveway from 12 to 18 feet, we believe, addresses the concerns brought up by the board at our workshop in August. The main entrance into the center will be through the existing garage, which will be renovated. We are proposing to remove the existing garage doors and install an entry from the driveway. The garage area will be the craft room, equipped with two wash sinks, which we are proposing to install, as well as desks and work area. Windows and an entry will be incorporated into the space previously occupied by the garage doors. In order to create a contiguous space, we are proposing to build an 8x8 addition to the backside of the house, which would connect the main house to the converted garage. A paved walkway and entrance for the home's occupants is also being proposed. A media room where video, audio, computer, and other individual and group activities will take place is planned. The game room, which will contain board games, ping pong, and access to the fenced-in play area, is at the further end of the center. The fenced-in area being proposed will occupy approximately 1,500 square feet on the easterly side of the building facing Patricia Drive. A 5-foot-high wood stockade fence is planned for the outside play area, which will be equipped with various playground equipment appropriate for school-aged children. except for new wallboard, ceilings, flooring, and other cosmetic renovations to the basement, none of the existing partitions will be changed. Currently, there exists a sump pump, which is currently directed to flow directly into Scott Dyer Road. We propose to redirect this so we'll exit onto the lawn opposite the driveway, which pitches away from the house onto the lawn on the easterly side of the house. Outside lights are being proposed at the new entryways, as well as installing a new light pole. We are proposing a shingle-type sign, 2 feet by 3 feet, be placed on the lawn indicating the name, telephone number, and entrance to the center. There is one existing apple tree whose limbs impede sight distance on the right side of the driveway. We have proposed to trim these limbs back in order to get the full 500 feet of side distance on the right. The left side distance is over 800 feet. We currently own a buildable lot on Patricia Drive, which someday will be sold or transferred. Therefore, in anticipation of this likely event, we are adding some landscape buffer to the back edge of the front lot with some transplanted lilac trees and evergreens. Sue Weatherby, who oversees the after-school program for the town of Cape Elizabeth, as well as coordinates school bus stops, has indicated that children will be picked up and dropped off at the end of our driveway. Our home is serviced by town water and sewer. The Portland Water District has assured us that our 3/4-inch water service is more than adequate to supply the water needs for a daycare center. We anticipate that there won't be an inordinate amount of solid waste generated by the center, mostly paper and craft supplies, which we will dispose of with our household waste at the town transfer station.
Thank you, Ms. Manini. For the benefit of those who may be in the audience and those viewing at home, I'd like to ask the town planner to give us a quick explanation of the status of the application at this point, noting that the applicants have already been before the zoning board to get a conditional use approval.
The applicants are requesting approval for a daycare facility, and that is considered a conditional use in this particular zone. So the applicants must first go to the zoning board and receive conditional use approval before they can proceed to the planning board. Conditional use approval is when you really do look at whether the use is appropriate in that zone. When considering whether the use is appropriate, you look at things like impact on the neighborhood, buffering, and an impact on abutting property values. The zoning board voted in favor of granting this conditional use permit, at which point it then is forwarded to...
There was a public hearing at the zoning board level?
Absolutely. Every meeting of the zoning board is a public hearing type meeting. The zoning board held a public hearing. They voted to grant a conditional use permit. It's then been forwarded to the planning board. The board held a workshop last month, is now back for a regular site plan application. The procedure to be followed would be for the board first to make a determination on whether or not the application is complete. If it's determined that it is complete, the board may choose to hold a public hearing, although one is not required. You may also choose to schedule a site walk. And after the application is deemed complete, at any point you can begin substantive discussion and review of the application.
And the concerns that the planning board would address would be different from those of the zoning board?
There's a little bit of overlap, but at this point, whether or not the use is appropriate in this part of town is not really within the purview of the planning board. The standards you should be looking at are the standards in section 19.95, which talk about how the site is designed. And those things include traffic and buffering, but whether or not a daycare facility is the appropriate use for this particular lot is not really within the purview of the planning board.
Thank you. I appreciate that because I think it's always important to, we have had a couple of letters and apparently some telephone calls on this project, and I do want to try to make it as clear as we can what it is that's appropriate for us to deal with and what is appropriate for the zoning board to deal with. So, with that background, the first order of business is the completeness issue. Now, could I ask you to run through the checklist and tell us where we are on that?
Certainly. Again, on page 4, there's a site plan review submission checklist. And again, on item 6, The applicant is requesting a waiver of the proposed building structures, roads, driveways, and parking areas on, and they're showing proposed buildings and structures. What they're not showing is an elevation drawing of the 8-by-8-foot addition to the rear of the structure. So the footprint is shown on the drawing. Under number nine, topography of existing and proposed contours at 5-foot intervals, the applicant has requested a waiver of that. They are arguing that, for the most part, they are not changing the topography at all and are therefore not providing that information. And those are the two waivers that have been requested.
Any discussion about completeness?
Could you go back to number six? I was trying to find the checklist. And repeat what you said, please.
Number six requires, is a summary that requires that proposed building structures, roads, driveways, and parking areas be shown on the plan. The applicant has shown all of that except they have not shown an elevation that shows the face of the addition that they're proposing, the 8-by-8-foot addition that's at the rear.
Okay, thank you.
So we might say this is a P instead of a W.
Yes, you could go with a P instead of a W.
Ms. Parker.
I'd like to make a motion for completeness.
Mm-hmm.
Motion for the board to consider be to order that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of Dana Rancourt and Lisa Manini for site plan review of a proposed daycare facility to be operated at 111 Scott Dyer Road to be deemed complete.
Is there a second?
Second, please.
Mr. Cotter, thank you. Any discussion? Further discussion, I should say. All right, all in favor of the motion as presented that the application be deemed complete, raise your right hand. It is unanimous. Now we proceed to the substantive discussion, including is there any interest in a public hearing or site walk? So I await further discussion. Anybody got any comments or questions?
I, for one, have no interest in a site walk or a public hearing.
Thank you.
Public hearing has already been held. It's necessary.
I personally see no need for a site walk or a public hearing where one has already been held and the application appears to be very complete.
When was the public hearing held?
The zoning board held a public hearing.
That's right. You said that.
I believe
that
it was
every
June 24th.
June.
Effectively, every meeting they have is deemed to be.
I can't hear you.
Effectively, every meeting that the zoning board has deemed to be a public hearing.
Yes, the zoning board tends to deal with an issue at one meeting and dispose of it much more rapidly than the planning board does, just because of the nature of how they handle things. So, every meeting is automatically noticed as an opportunity for people to comment on the items on the agenda. So this was only on one zoning board agenda.
I don't share the view that that a public hearing isn't necessary just because the issue came before the zoning board. In my view, I'm trying to think of how to say this and say it appropriately. I think the planning board is viewed as more of a public forum than is the zoning board by the general citizenry. It's my view, and would not be comfortable assuming that public hearing isn't necessary just because the zoning board had one. Sidewalk, I think matters not, but we have received some correspondence where people have expressed concern about the project. I think it's incumbent on us to make sure that that's fully heard and that we take the additional step to make sure that if anybody wants to come forward, they have the opportunity to do so.
Well, thank you for saying so, Mr. Azzolino, because I also agree with you. I think that although your terminology was delicate with respect to the zoning board, I guess I have a slightly different take on it, and that is, regardless if there were a thorough public hearing that lasted for three zoning board sessions, I think the idea of a public hearing is so the people who are making the determination can hear from the public, and I was not present at the public hearing before the zoning board, so I don't know what people said there. And because of the level of public interest in this project, I think I, for one, would like to offer the opportunity for anyone who wants to address us in public as well as in writing to have the opportunity to do so before we decide. So my inclination is always to hold a public hearing if there is any expression from the public about the concern for the process. So I guess that's where I come down on it as one board member. Mr. Parkhurst.
At the risk of sounding foolish, I had the impression from when Maureen gave us the introduction here that the appropriateness of the project and the location is not of the, you know, not in the purview of the planning board. So I fail to see the necessity of a public hearing, since we have, the zoning board has already said this is an appropriate use. We are now here to do the nuts and bolts part of it.
Is that a fair characterization of what you said, Maureen?
I'm not going to say that you don't need to hold a public hearing.
I think it's fair to say that the zoning board decided the issue of the usage of the daycare facility as an appropriate usage in this zone. But questions concerned with buffering, questions concerning traffic, questions concerning safety, all of those issues are absolutely squarely on our plate and need to be addressed. And I would like to hear from the public with respect to the issues that are issues that we're supposed to be concerned with.
Fine. I thought we were going in another direction with this public hearing. That's why I said what I did.
I don't intend to stray from the concerns that we are legitimately supposed to be concerned with. Mr. Emery.
Madam Chair, I think it's going to be, with a public hearing, I think it'll be difficult for the public not to treat us as a zoning board, and that's generally the gist of the comments in the letters. However, this use is a unique animal in town. This can drop within almost any neighborhood, and I mean, we've had a reasonable amount of correspondence here. Some of the affected abutters are here this evening, and I think it's important that the planning board, even though we are trying to be customer-friendly and move these projects along as quickly as possible, and as innocuous or inane as a small child care center may seem in on the one hand, I think it's really important that the neighbors have an opportunity to come before the board and express their concerns. I think it ultimately will help you as the owner of the property, and it'll help the planning board hear things or see things that we can't interpret in writing. And I think it's a very important courtesy to extend to any abutter. I know if this came in my neighborhood and I weren't afforded the opportunity to express my concerns in a public forum before the planning board, I'd be very discouraged. I'd be discouraged, probably more discouraged after the zoning board meeting, but there may be fine-tuning, there may be things that can be done with this plan that the abutters could comment on that would alleviate a lot of the concerns that they might have about traffic that the board may not pick up on. So I think it's important to have a public hearing.
Thank you, Mr. Emery. Any further comments or discussions? Do I hear any further comments about the desirability or non-desirability of the public hearing? We've got three people expressing an interest in it, and two people expressing not an interest in it. Is that fair? And one silent person.
Well, I will add my opinion of the interest of the public in site plan review revolve around public use of facilities, and I believe that the traffic and safety issues that are particular to this site have been effectively addressed by the applicant in their design. And I don't believe that it is within the purview of the planning board to deal with traffic issues in the town at large, which has already been dealt with by the Zoning Board of Appeals. Therefore, I think that we have the ability and the duty to proceed and review the plan.
Without a public hearing?
Without a public hearing.
Well, it's the lefts against the rights tonight. Too bad Mr. Carlson's not here. We don't have an odd number. Any further discussion?
Maybe appropriate that the chair
I could ask
make a decision in this draw, so to speak.
Well, I think I would say that, Mr. Parkhurst, go ahead.
My original comments were made thinking that we were going in a certain direction because of the letters we'd received, and I also want to extend every courtesy to every abutter to the property. I really wasn't thinking, given that we have a whole empty lot in between the proposed facility and the next door neighbor, it seems to be from the pictures fairly heavily wooded, that we really had much of a buffering concern or a traffic concern. But out of the deference to the townspeople, I will certainly support the idea of having a public hearing, although I think it's unnecessary.
Well, thank you for the courtesy. I guess I would say, when in doubt, I would tend to err in favor of a public hearing unless there's strong vote against it. So if I could exercise the prerogative of the chair, I think I would attempt to set a public hearing for the next meeting. That doesn't mean, however, that we couldn't proceed to discuss some of the substantive issues this evening if people had particular questions about the application, or we could save those questions for the next meeting. If anybody's got any specifics that they'd like to communicate to the applicant, I think now would be the time to do it. Yes, Mr. Parker.
I went through this, and I have a couple things. This is one of the better applications I think I've seen in 7 years on the planning board as far as everything being here, being a very logical, very easy to read, and not being confusing at all. And the pictures were absolutely wonderful. It really helped a lot. That being said, in reading it, it seems to me that the one big thing that I have is the town engineer has noted that we, the RP1 buffer can be diminished by 30 feet or reduced by 30 feet. Seems to me that the turnaround should be increased so there won't be any backing and filling when people drive through. And sort of close to my heart, my wife owns a nursery school in Falmouth, and I know what the traffic problem can be like. She has a huge facility in comparison to this, and it's a nightmare. And I just really think you'd be better off if you went for that reduction and made the turnaround larger with an island in it, whether it be a seasonal island so it'd be easy to plow in the wintertime, you know, with a some statuary or something so you have traffic directed around it for the non-inclement months. I think it would be a very big benefit to you in the long run. And that's, and other than that, trimming the apple trees, I'm not going to have any further input the next meeting.
You promise?
I promise.
Any further comments? Thank you, Mr. Parkhurst. Mr. Emery.
Regarding the application, just a couple of comments. The applicant has indicated that they may sell or put into separate ownership the abutting lot that you currently own, in which case it would seem that the proposed parking area is extremely close to the property line, and that may be an area where headlights would be shining through, so I think particular attention should be taken at that point. I also, did I understand that you said that the children would be 16 years or younger than 16 years?
Yes.
And how many are there, 16?
No, it would be up to 12.
Up to 12. What happens, I have two children under the age of over 12 and under 16, 16 and under, 16 and 15. What happens with that age group? There's a small play area here, relatively speaking, but it's not clear to me what happens if you end up with a, I'm not supposing you would end up with that with teenagers, but if you did, it seems as though you're able to under the license, and certainly by the granting of this conditional use by the zoning board, you would be able to take in teenagers. How do they fit into the overall program of the facility?
Well, they would be involved in activities as far as the adopt a grandparent. There are also many activities where they would be able to be on the computer and ping pong games and study times and treks to the beach, and I think people of all ages would enjoy. So I'm...
I recall years ago when my children were in nursery school, I think it was at Rand Hill, and even in the early years at Pond Cove, they did come down to the Viking nursing home, and that was 10 years ago or longer. So there has been, contrary to, I think, some of the questions in the correspondence, there has been an ongoing relationship there. And I think that's a wonderful opportunity. Most children don't get into that environment, and we all fear the environment, so to speak, and I certainly support that effort as part of this program. I would assume that in that case, any children crossing Scott Dyer Road would be escorted by someone assigned to them. I also, in the correspondence, have read comments regarding concern about children straying from the property and ending up on other people's properties and becoming injured or something to that effect. I don't know that that's any different than anyone else having a neighbor with children that would be growing up and stray off the property, jump in your car, take it out of transmission out. I suppose the only difference is here is that there are a few families that had 12, 16, and even more children, but this is 12 children that now, these days, is a fairly large group of children in a single-family setting. But I think that would be the only concern, that it may provide an opportunity for increase with more children, that there may be more opportunities for that. But I think that's typically it's your management of the facility, along with everyone having the normal homeowner's insurance and insurance against those situations. But I don't see anything. This facility could be here for any number of years without a problem, and someone could move in next door on Patricia Avenue or on Scott Dyer Road or from my neighborhood and have a bunch of hooligans, unsupervised hooligans for children that could be running through these neighborhoods and causing problems. So I don't see that in and of itself as a specific concern, unless it's something like this facility would be located at the far end of Patricia Drive and all of these house lots would become a shortcut to a destination point, but it doesn't seem that that's the case in this situation. So. I guess that's my other comment. The other thing is that the previous owner of this house had cleaned up the edge of the stream that runs along there, and I guess had been caught by either code enforcement officer or the Conservation Commission and was made to restore it to its original or existing conditions. I kind of like the irises myself, but I understand the concern on the Conservation Commission. 22-foot radius is tight, but it's not unmanageable. If you think of a 22-foot wide, I mean, if that's a 40-foot, 4-foot wide street, you can go up a 40-foot, 4-foot wide street and make a sweeping U-turn, at least in a mid-sized car. I don't know if you can do that in a large Bronco or something to that effect, but I think Steve's experience probably is something to be concerned about. It's a matter of weighing the increase in paved area versus encroaching on the wetland setback. What happens when a school bus comes down Scott Dyer Road and stops on in front of the house? The flashes go on like at any other house, the traffic stops, and it's the same situation. My other question is that the plan labels several plants around the fence as transplanted shrubs. Are those new shrubs to be planted, or are those coming from someplace else on the property?
It actually related to them as transplanted shrubs.
That's all right. they're coming from adjacent to the house. Okay. Have you stated anywhere in your application, I don't recall seeing it, what type of play equipment you're anticipating or if any within the play area?
We haven't specified that. I'm going to be working with a specialist in daycare and developing the needs of the children, but most likely a jungle gym or a playset, something like that, with sandboxes, you know, that'll be covered at night, yes, and things of that nature.
So it's the typical play equipment that doesn't create extraordinary noise or anything that's uncharacteristic of other play equipment in single-family neighborhood. I thought I heard from the workshop that this was a commercial-zoned area. It's RA? RC, okay. And the minimum lot size for conditional use is whatever the underlying RC zone stipulates, and that is all met here with this existing house lot. That's all the questions I have.
Thank you, Mr. Emery. Anybody else?
Madam Chair, I have several. Address this to the planner. In terms of the ordinance that governs use, is there any, and I say this for purposes of the record, is there any restriction on number of children in a daycare facility?
The only restriction is that if it's less than six children, then it's not a daycare facility, it's a daycare home. So there's no restriction on the upper number on how many you can have there. Typically, I don't know if the zoning board set a limit on it, but typically an upper limit is usually set as part of the approval. And we've actually had a couple of daycare facilities come back to the planning board and the zoning board because they're increasing in size. So it is standard that you set a number, and that's what you get approval for. And if you're going to go beyond that maximum number, you have to come back.
And that approval would be set by the zoning board?
I'd have to check to see whether the zoning board actually set a maximum, but the planning board could also tie a maximum number to your site plan approval.
But there's no requirement. It's either set or it isn't.
That's right.
Ma'am, could you address that? Was an upper limit in terms of number of children set? And the 12 that you mentioned 12, is that just what you view as
an... Well, that's with the state.
I'm sorry.
The state, the requirements are you apply for a certain amount of children, and I would be applying for 3 to 12 children.
So your state license is limiting...
Yes, exactly, through the state.
I see. And if we were to establish a maximum consistent with that, our own, mm-hmm. would that cause you any problem?
No. It was 12 or?
Yeah, I mean, assuming you're, I know, but I assume you can also go back to the state and ask, I don't know how it works. I guess you can go back to the state and ask for an amendment to your license, a different license, and go from 12 to some other number.
Yes.
Is that not right? And in the license requirement from the state, is there an age restriction on that in your state licensing?
No.
So please help me with this. The only restriction really in terms of numbers is
no older than 16.
Okay, but you already mentioned that. So it's a max of 16, and the maximum number is 12. And it is not your intent to go beyond either age 16 or numbers 12.
Exactly.
Is that
yes.
Fair?
Yes.
One other question. Just interest. Your application specifically talks about the objective of wanting to encourage the interface with the residents of the biking nursing facility. Obviously, very, very laudable objective. Could you explain that? I'm trying to understand the link between the daycare and the nursing facility.
Okay, the daycare would be run separately, but we would also like to have programs if the residents want to come over and do like an adoptive grandparent once a week.
I see.
Holiday activities, you know, us going over and caroling with the residents and trick-or-treating. To do a, you know, at least a weekly kind of exposure between the children and the residents.
Is it your expectation then that, parents who would put their children in your facility would be doing that specifically because they're interested in that interface?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. That's what I wanted to clarify. Those are all my questions.
And would that interface occur at the daycare facility or at the Viking or both?
Both. Most the weekly activities would be at the daycare, but as far as going over and caroling throughout the facility, that would be at the facility.
So on a rainy day, when you can't be out in the backyard, you've got everybody either in the craft room or the media room or the game room? And on rainy days, if you want to have Viking people, they're all in one of those rooms? Okay. I echo the comments that have been made so far. I'm particularly concerned about the traffic and the way that works, that traffic circle. So I will take it upon myself to drive by. I take it we don't have any need for a site walk. I didn't hear any great groundswell for that, but I think we can just all be responsible for driving by the corner between now and the next meeting and taking a quick look at it on the face of the earth, so to speak. I think that I have no further concerns that I know about at this point. So any further comments, questions for the applicant? If not, excuse me, I beg your pardon, Mr. Wilcox.
I have one observation on the circular turnaround area to sort of echo what Mr. Parker said, although I'm not sure that something in the middle is necessarily the answer without the area being much larger. But the size of the area right now seems to be at such a size that it could work, given an orderly, polite behavior by drivers, which is not necessarily guaranteed in the town of Cape Elizabeth. If the 100-foot diameter turnarounds up at the schools are any indication, people are in a hurry and they leapfrog and they stop and they want to get close to the door and they stop and take their things inside and just gum up the works for everybody else. So if you have and can present to us how you see this circle actually working in day-to-day practice, I for one would be very interested in seeing that.
Thank you for your comments. And we have to be thinking about these on rainy days and snow days and harried days and everything else. Any further comments on this application or questions? Okay, do I hear a motion to table this until the next meeting, at which time a public hearing will be held?
So moved.
Mr. Emery.
Once again, motion for completeness.
Aha. Uh-huh. Did we do this?
Did we do that?
I think we did. We did it in the right order this time, so we got the motion for completeness done.
Well, let's see here.
Start with the order.
Motion, therefore, be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of Dana Rancourt and Lisa Menini for site plan review of the proposed daycare facility to be operated at 111 Scott Dyer Road be tabled to the regular October 1997 Planning Board meeting, at which time a public hearing shall be held.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
Thank you. Any further discussion? All in favor of the motion, please raise your right hand. It is unanimous. Thank you very much. We'll be sending out the regular notices and look forward to seeing you in October.
Maureen, I've got a question. When the zoning board does a public hearing, do they notice the neighbors?
Yes. They send a notice for every item on the agenda.
Any other business before the planning board that was not on the agenda? If not, this meeting is adjourned. Or do we need to take a vote? I always just do this.
Is anyone missing their zoning news? I got two this one.
No.
I'm missing the blue packet for the Rancor Daycare Center.
Oh, you are?
She'll get you one.
I have all the printed stuff, I just don't have the pictures and the map.
Now I know what that extra one was for.
Thank you all for coming.
Can I?
Oh.
So I just walked.